Long-term research is extremely important because it allows us to collect lots of small data points and slowly over time start to see meaningful patterns emerge. I'd like to spend a few minutes telling you about an important long-term organic systems study that we began in 2003. The short name for the study is SOCS, just like the socks that you wear on your feet. I'll tell you later why I think the SOCS abbreviation is important. So the SOCS experiment is located in the heart of the Salinas Valley, and it's one of the relatively few long-term systems experiments that's focused on high-value, high-input crops. Cool-seasoned vegetables and strawberries are the cash crops in the study, but I'm going to focus on the first 8 years of commercial-scale vegetable production. And we'll look at how organic matter inputs from compost and from a legume-rye cover crop affected several different things. I'll just focus on three systems that we'll identify with these three colors. All three systems had the same vegetable crops each year, lettuce and then usually broccoli. Now, system three, the green one, it got a legume-rye cover crop every single winter, and system one and two only got a cover crop every fourth winter, and they were fallow the other three winters. So cover cropping frequency was a major difference between these systems. Now, another way that they differed was system two and three also got yard waste compost right before each of the vegetable crops, but system one never got any compost. This figure shows you the cumulative inputs of organic matter from cover crop shoots and compost in the winter, the spring, and the summer of each year. So with system one that never got compost, the organic matter input came from a winter cover crop during year four and then year eight. Now I'll use a pink circle to help us remember that the organic matter here came from a cover crop. Now system two also was cover cropped every fourth winter, and it also got compost in the spring and the summer. And then system three got a cover crop every winter and compost each spring and summer. These systems represent three very different scenarios for certified organic vegetable production in our region. Now here's another graph that shows the total nitrogen input during the 8 years of vegetable production from pelleted and liquid organic fertilizers. These are very commonly used in our area. Also from biological nitrogen fixation that was estimated based on the growth of the legume component in the cover crop, and then from compost in system two and three. Now it's important to remember that in all other aspects of the systems during vegetable production, there were no differences in terms of tillage, irrigation, weed management, etc. The only way that they differed was in terms of cover cropping frequency, every year versus every fourth year, and then compost. So let's look at some of the results on how these three different management strategies affected lettuce yields, because this is the salad bowl of the world, soil health, because this is an important and hot research topic right now, and then phosphorus budgets, because phosphorus plays a critical role in our bodies, and it's also a limited resource that needs to be more carefully managed. So in this area, lettuce is often packed in boxes of 24 heads, and usually a box needs to weigh about 30 pounds to be marketable. We'll start with system three that got compost and the winter cover crop every year. So these large dots connected by the line are the average yields, and the small dots are the four replicates that show the variability in the data. In most years, the average marketable yield was at least 1,000 boxes per acre in this system. This is excellent. Now in system two that got compost but was only cover cropped every fourth winter, look at how bad the yields were the first 3 years and how they were highest during year four and year eight. Now the same basic pattern with high yields during year four and eight also happened in system one that never got compost and was only cover cropped every fourth winter. Now let me combine these three plots so that we can see the major trends. So what's going on here? Why did the yields of system one and two increase dramatically during year four and year eight? Well, I think it's because system one and two got a winter cover crop right before the lettuce of year four and year eight. And this shows the remarkable power of a cover crop to boost yields. So how does the cover crop do this? Well, here's what I think is happening. Remember that these are high input organic systems where we had lots of nitrogen-rich fertilizers to the vegetables. The nitrogen input from the fertilizer in broccoli was usually about 160 kilograms per hectare each year. And when a crew like this harvests the broccoli, only about 25% of the total shoot biomass, that is just the top part that we eat, is removed from the field. So in other words, most of the nitrogen in the broccoli plant is left in the field in nitrogen-rich leaves and shoots. So these leftover parts are mowed and then incorporated back into the soil, and if the field is left in a bare winter fallow after broccoli, all that leftover nitrogen can leach out of the root zone and down into the groundwater. But when you have a winter cover crop after the broccoli, the cover crop is able to capture the leftover nitrogen and recycle it back into the next spring lettuce crop. Now you might be wondering whether the nitrogen fixation by the legume component in that cover crop mixture also helped to increase yields in system one and system two right after they were cover cropped. This may have helped a little bit, but I don't think it did much because we also have high lettuce yields in other systems in the experiment where we grew only non-legume cover crops every year. So I think that the primary nutrient management benefit of winter cover cropping in these high input organic systems is to improve nutrient cycling and storage, which can reduce fertilizer inputs and protect the groundwater. Okay, so now let's talk about soil health. Now to do this, I'm going to use microbial biomass carbon, which is a sensitive biological indicator of soil health. The size of this diverse microbial community, or its biomass, is important because these wonderful microbes regulate the transformation and the storage of nutrients in the soil. They're the living part of soil organic matter. Generally, as the microbial biomass increases, so does soil health. So here's a graph that shows the change in microbial biomass carbon over the first 6 years of vegetable production. These bars are the 95% confidence intervals with the average in the middle and then the raw data of the four replicates. So it's very clear that the greatest improvement in soil health was in system three that was cover cropped every winter and got compost. In contrast, there was some evidence of an actual decline in system one, and just a slight improvement in system two that also got compost but was seldom cover cropped. So these data agree with the lettuce yield data in the benefits of frequent cover cropping. Now for the phosphorus budgets during the first 8 years of vegetable production. So these bars represent the amount of phosphorus that went into the systems from fertilizer, compost, cover crop seed, and vegetable transplants. And the second bar here in each of these systems shows the amount of phosphorus that was taken out in the harvested vegetables. So it's very clear that we applied far more phosphorus than was needed in these systems. In other words, the nutrient budgets in these systems were not in balance. Now, I've been interested in balance for many years, long before I became a scientist. This is me as a teenager in my home country of Papua New Guinea with one of my friends, and I realized that if you want to go far, you've got to have good balance. The concept of balance also applies in our agricultural systems. For them to be sustainable, they have to be balanced in many different ways. And the imbalance that I've seen with phosphorus in our long-term study makes me question the organic regulations which prohibit farmers from using pure synthetic nitrogen. This regulation often leads us to apply far more phosphorus in these high-input organic systems as we try to meet the nitrogen needs of the crops. Now, you might want to check out this other video that I made where I suggest that organic farmers should be allowed to use pure synthetic nitrogen. Now, as you can tell, I didn't wear shoes or socks when I was a lot younger, and I still occasionally enjoy going barefoot at work. But usually I wear socks because they help to protect my feet in our world as it's become more and more crowded. I like the abbreviation for our study, SOCS, because it reminds me of my feet and about the footprint of our agriculture on the world and the importance of developing systems that minimize that footprint. SOCS also reminds me that to make progress in a journey, you have to have lots of socks. You can't just have one sock on one foot. What about the other foot? It won't be very happy. In other words, we need lots of long-term studies. I hope that tomorrow when you put on your socks, you think about the SOCS experiment and why this type of long-term research is critical. Thanks for listening.